Hi, Expat Explore community. Welcome to episode 10 of On the Road with Vic, Luke, Brandon, and Matt.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Hello.
So I just want to start off by saying how nice it is to see you guys. I've missed you. Yeah, love each week when we catch up. It's just so good to see
you. We miss you, Vic.
I don't know if more's happened, but it feels like it's been longer than a week since I've seen you guys. I was ready 3 hours before we started today because I was that excited.
Yeah, you're very excited today, Luke.
I know. I feel like even if
more overexcited than usual.
Yeah, even if nobody out there is watching our episodes, like
we're
just gonna keep doing them anyway, just so that we can catch up and keep in touch.
And ever.
Welcome to episode 7,824 on the road.
Our beards will be down here.
People just talking about life.
Oh, yeah. With our one follower. I know we do actually have, even though maybe there's not that many, we do actually have a couple of really loyal followers. So thank you, everybody that is watching us. So this week you might notice that we're just back to the four of us. So we decided just to have a week's break from having a guest on. And I think next week we're going to have another guest, actually a guy called Willem from South Africa. So that'll definitely be one to tune in for. So a buddy of... Brandon's in South Africa still, of course, but I think he's in a different town from you, yeah?
Yeah, he's in Cape Town, so where our expat head office is.
And where are you again? Remind us.
I'm in Durban, opposite side of the country.
Ah, yes, you're
so in. We're the land of zero winter. It's fantastic.
Ah, yes.
Sunny every day.
You're very lucky. That's, one of the things that I'm not enjoying about being down here in New Zealand. We have winter. But so Willem will be on next week. And this week it's just the four of us. And of course, in the coming weeks, we will continue to have our lovely colleagues join us for some of the episodes and talk about their upcoming tours. So of course, we have some tours that have been allocated to us as well, which you guys might have seen that we've put on Facebook. And we have a little bit of time. I think you guys will all agree, that 2020. Yeah. 2020 is gone. So there's a few weeks left in the year. So we're going to be talking about our individual tours over the coming weeks. So we're going to actually dedicate a week each to each of us to go through those tours that we've got. So I'll remind you guys in the comments what.
Vic, you're on mute.
Yeah, I was going to say,
you've muted.
He's definitely muted. Did you push the button again?
Have I muted? Did I mute and then re-mute myself?
You did, yeah.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Okay, so what I was saying, guys, is that I'm going to put the dates for our tours in the comments. And then if you want to hear about those tours, you'll have to just tune in the coming weeks. So
we'll dive into those at a late date. We're going to get deep as can be within those tours, all the details, what they're about,
I'm a bit worried we're gonna get too excited, like just picturing being back on the road.
Too excited, man. Is it possible to be too excited?
FOMO is gonna be through the roof.
But just to give you a little taster, we will mention the tours. So Luke's got a couple of Great Britain and Ireland tours allocated to him. Matt, what have you got? You've got a Best of Greece and
Croatia and Eastern Delight. So start from Munich, goes down to Croatia, back through the Balkans, Budapest, Prague, and back to Munich.
Yeah,
amazing.
That sounds
amazing.
Delicious.
Basically a foodie tour.
Yeah. And the best of
every tour is a foodie tour to you, Brandon.
I know. That's what I miss the most. Is I'm sick of my own cooking. All I want to do is go and eat at a nice.
Oh, your cooking's amazing, though, mate.
Your cooking is amazing.
Thanks.
Yeah.
I'm like, I know.
That's what I'm missing, though. I'm missing my locals in every city. Like, I'm missing my favorite cafe place in Paris, and then
You do after a couple of times there, you get your locals, you get your favorite spots, and they're probably missing us. You know, I think all those cafe owners, damn, where's that hairy loud tour guide that always comes in?
What about the mountain view in Greenwich? It's probably like, where's those?
Our Indian restaurant in Greenwich, Matt.
Oh, I know.
I'll start crying.
Mountain view in Greenwich. Goodness gracious.
Oh, yeah.
You're back.
I might go down there next week. I'll send you guys a picture.
Damn you, Luke. That's cruel.
I can still go. Next Zoom meeting, we're going to do it, and I'll be in Mountain View and Greenwich.
Eating the curry in front of us.
He'll just be lapping up a doll and just be like, how good is this?
No, Luke, we'll have to cut you.
Well, I thought I just cut out. My internet just froze then, and you all froze. So I was like, I've been cut out anyway. So obviously, the internet didn't do that.
Delete.
Okay.
Denied.
Right. Moving along. So, Brandon, you have got a taste of France. Yep. Yes. And you also have
the Balkan Explorer.
Balkan Explorer, like me. So me and Brandon have both got a Balkan Explorer. Then I've got the Northern Explorer. So over the coming weeks and months, we're going to go into those in a little bit more detail, and then you can book with us or you can book with our colleagues. Just wanted to also just mention with that, like with expat, you normally can't choose your tour leader. And I think that's a really good thing, because we're all really good, right? So
it's a lucky dip where you win every time.
Exactly. Yeah. It's like a little bit of a lottery. So, and I think it is quite hard to allocate tour leaders in advance, because you never know what's going to happen. So this is just a little bit of a special thing where you can potentially travel with us again if you've traveled with us before. But no matter what tour you like and what tour you want to go on, whether it's with one of us or any of our friends that we've interviewed or any of the other expat tour leaders, you know, you're sure to have a good time. So
yeah, we've got the best of the best.
Yeah. But we just want to talk about the tours that are coming up so that you guys can pick what you like the sound of. Anyway, we're going to move away from that just for this episode, and we want to take it back to something a little bit more lighthearted and maybe a little bit funny. We're going to discuss some things that people like yourselves, not you guys, tour leaders, but you know, people that are watching us, expat explore community and passengers, might sometimes do on tour by mistake. So we've talked about our mishaps as tour leaders. Yeah. Now we're going to talk about mishaps that passengers can make. And we don't want to make it...
never. You know, never happens, mate.
Mine don't make mistakes.
The aim of the game is not to embarrass or humiliate anyone. It's really just to maybe tell some funny stories. And then we thought we could... talk about how you can
More about like to give like passengers, people that are going to travel in the future, a bit of advice of do's and don'ts, because coming on tour is like, it's a big deal for us as tour leaders, but for passengers as well. It's not all fun and games, you know. There's a lot you have to do, a lot of timings, a lot of cultural faux pas that you have to be aware of, a lot of things that can go wrong, and it requires a lot of teamwork on behalf of passengers and the tour leaders.
It comes with so many challenges as well. We meet them at 6 o'clock at the Novotel in Greenwich, and we're like, "Hi, I'm Brandon. I'm now going to talk to you for 45 minutes."
And everyone's
until
lying.
We get to the ferry, and they're like, "I'm jet lagged. I'm out."
45 minutes? Don't you mean like 2 hours?
What, to the ferry?
2 hours minimum. Yeah. It's like, what? We're at the ferry already? Oh my god.
And the worst is when you don't go on the ferry and you go across on the train, because then you can keep talking and talking.
Oh my god, I know.
And they're like, can we just not listen to you? Like, just for 10 minutes.
They get a break on the train. They get a break.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay, so let's just, because we don't have heaps of time, because we've already talked for a bit, let's break it down into four different categories. And then we can just have a little bit of a chat about it and then see how we go. So I reckon the first thing we should talk about is... things that can happen with regards to food, dietaries, and restaurants. I see some head nodding there. So, what do you guys got?
and we all stay still.
Okay, so Matt,
this is where you come in, Matt. Is a...
Matt has some advice for you.
I don't have any particular incident to share. It's just a bit of a pet peeve, perhaps. Everyone's very nice and polite and stuff, but when the food orders come out, usually there's people have had some choices of what they want for their main, or beef, chicken, whatever, or vegetarian. Servers will come out and they're like, who had the chicken? And often people kind of sit there and they just nod. And, you know, they don't understand that the waiters, waitresses, they're looking at 50 people. Please put your hand up. So they go, sir, madam.
Just put your hand up, make a big noise, make a song and dance, just say me.
Make it very
communication.
You
Get caught up.
Just you sitting there and just doing this, like they don't see it.
Mm-hmm. What was that, Brandon?
I'm not the chicken. So sometimes I say to people to write it down on their hand, because sometimes you know, when you talk about a meal, you might be prepping for 2 days in advance. So I say, okay, so not tonight. Tonight we're having that, but tomorrow we'll be having, this is your choices. So that day I remind them and I say, okay, so Susan, you'll be having the beef. So I ask them to write it down on their hand, because when you get to the restaurant, sometimes they're a bit confused, or not so much confused, but everyone's chatting, there's wine flowing, they're talking about their day, and then a waiter comes to the restaurant.
On Brandon's tours, there's a lot of wine flowing.
Hey, hi ladies, hi everyone, here's, we've got the beef, who's having beef? And then people just freeze. And I'm like, Susan, you're having the beef. Look, it's all
I know, write Poor it down, Susan. People. Yeah. If you can't remember what you've had, write it down. Excellent advice, Brandon.
Yeah,
otherwise,
for sure.
I mean, we spend the whole meal running around the restaurant looking paper, like trying to figure out who ordered what.
With a list of 50, okay, who's ordered what? And sometimes it's three courses, four courses.
Mm-hmm. And one thing with that, and this was what I wanted to bring up, and it was exactly what you mentioned with when you choose your food. Often people have dietaries. Of course, some of those people have allergies, and maybe people are vegetarians, or they can't eat, you know, red meat. They eat chicken, or they eat or whatever, you know. So I had this one tour. Now, you know who you are.
No.
If you're watching, I do love you. But there was this one guy on one of my tours who always without fail took the dietary food, because it came
it
out
better sometimes. Yeah, they came out first.
I honestly think that's what he did. He was looking, he thought it looked good, and he was like, yeah, that's for me. And so this poor person who couldn't eat like meat always ended up missing out. So I had to basically watch him,
the food police.
Like rip
watch
the plate
him
away,
like a hawk. And I remember one time we were in Helsinki, and there was no other option, because the kitchen was like just set up for just the exact number of plates that we had, and there was no way we could get anything else. And I knew that was the case, and I saw the waiter put down the fish in front of this man, and it wasn't four, and he got his fork and knife up, and he started to, and I had to run across the restaurant and then grab the plate from underneath. Like, don't eat that.
Yeah, but that's it, is it? That's like, because what I tell them is like, if you take a dish that's not yours, you're stealing from someone else, and that is an imbalance. You've got to keep the balance, you know, like, and you know, I know some people are hungry, and obviously you're starving, you've been driving for 6 hours, you've been eating nothing but stale peanuts out of a bag found down the side of a chair, and when you see
the chicken comes,
and you see the beautiful chicken, you're like, fuck, I probably didn't order chicken, but that looks great, and I'm so hungry, you're going to put your hand up. I've probably done it before, you know, and I understand, but if you do that, the
system
collapses.
You can't do it on the plane.
Also, it's like, I think one thing that's difficult is like, when you're, obviously you go to a restaurant, you order your food, and you expect the waiter or waitress to know what you ordered, because you've placed your order with them specifically. But obviously, like Matt said, when the waiters and waitresses come out, you've got a group of 50 people. They've just been given a list that says 50, 25 beef, 5 vegetarian. And so they don't know who it's for. So it's that element of communication of announcing what you ordered when it comes is so important. A big hand in the air. So important.
When it happens in Albania as well, you know, they told me it was beef, but it was veal. And I had a lady who was like, I'm not eating veal. so, you know, and then trying to communicate that in Albania, You know, things seem to go a little bit wrong.
Yeah, I think that's like you gotta like understand there's gotta be a bit of flexibility, because sometimes the restaurant will tell you, we've got beef, but actually it's veal. Or they'll say there are slight variations of dishes. So you definitely people have to be open minded. Like you said it was chicken with slightly grilled potatoes and a little bit of salt on it, but instead the potatoes have come slightly mashed with pepper instead of salt, and you're like, oh well, sorry about that.
Well, you know,
the joys of traveling in a group.
We could go on for hours.
We could, yeah.
What's the next category?
Let's move on to the next category.
Okay, all right. Okay. So our next category is about border crossings. So who has some advice on border crossings?
I do, and it involves weapons.
Again, weapons.
Again, yes. And so ultimately, it comes down to, if you're crossing a border, do not be running around with knives in the air. And especially do not let your children be running around waving knives in the air. And this was a thing that actually happened. And we had this kid on tour who was one of my favorite. Like, I always get the best kids on tour. They're always amazing. I think they add so much to it. I've heard horror stories. I've never had bad experiences. Tours, even when it's gone wrong, it's usually been funny, and they often remind me of myself. And I was a very cheeky child, always getting up to sorts of mischief and stuff like that. And so we were at the Hungarian border, and it was my first time taking a group into Eastern Europe, and I was pre-warned that the Eastern European border crossings can be a little bit more intense than some of the borders we're used to. And so I was already a bit on edge. I was a bit nervous. My body was all like this. And I was like, okay, we're at the border. I'm ready. I prepared everyone. The driver was Hungarian. And so I was like, okay, everyone's where they need to be. We were stopped for about 30 minutes. I've got my little bottles of Coke to give us the bribes that apparently I was told to do. Wasn't sure if it was. Turns out it does work. And I look out the window and a few passengers are outside. That's fine. The guards are coming over. They're looking very serious with their big muscles and their serious faces.
That Hungarian border is quite hectic as well.
Yeah, man. It's pretty hectic. And it's such a hot day. Yeah. And they're walking towards us and they're coming over. And I look round and there is young little Max, who's an absolute legend. He's the coolest little guy. But at this moment, he just happens to be holding a Swiss Army knife. And this Swiss Army knife, the blade is out. And he's like, look at my knife, guys. Look how cool this is. And I'm like, start sweating. And I'm like, Max, no, what are you doing? The guards are coming over. Run over and like, Max, you've got to put this away. That's a very cool pen knife. It's awesome. I'm very pleased that you have it. I had one just like it when I was a kid. But now is not the time.
Please don't play with this.
Put it away, yeah. And so he put it away and all was fine. And I had a little chat with the parents and they were cool about it. We all had a good laugh. But yeah, if you've got any, don't bring them out.
I can understand how that feels, Luke, because I get paranoid when people run out with their cameras because you can't take pictures of borders.
Yeah.
And when people are traveling and they're not driving, they don't really care. So they just sometimes, you say, please don't take photos of the borders, but they kind of want the photo anyway. So you have people run up.
Well, they want that. They want that.
A border is a momentous occasion,
don't they? They want that. You are now entering.
Yeah, and
that's usually
you're
where
now entering, or the flag, the Hungarian flag, or something.
I want those
the
photos
flag.
Too, though.
They're amazing photos, but it's just gonna get you in trouble. And I was like, please don't.
I know it is really. Serious when you come to a border, isn't it? And one of the things that our drivers might thank us for is please, I know you hear us and the tour guide always tells you, but please have your passport on you when you know that you're going to be crossing a border, because the last thing the driver wants to do when we pull up to the border is what?
Pull your suitcases out of the bottom of the coast, you find your passports. Yes, please.
Yeah.
So, you know, we were talking about passports. Sometimes they're something that gets left behind in Europe because it gets so comfortable with not going through borders. But then every now and then you do have to go through a border. So have you ever had instances where people leave their passports in their rooms?
Yeah.
It's like the worst thing ever.
Yeah.
There's something that's... Have you guys all frozen?
Luke froze for a minute and then you did. Yeah. Okay, now we're back.
I think I'm back.
Luke, you're... Brandon, you're frozen now.
Cool. Well, I'm here, so I will talk. No, I'm only joking. Matt, but wait, before we get on to that, I think Matt also had a bit of a border incident that he mentioned the other day.
Of prohibited items.
Yeah.
You had a weapon. I had a suspicion, just a suspicion of drugs. started the tour in Amsterdam doing the Northern Explorer. We crossed into Sweden. And during the migrant crisis, a lot of migrants went to Sweden because they were quite open border policy. And because they had the big influx, they kind of tightened things a bit. So often now we are passport checked as we come into Sweden off the ferry. Border guards come on, they're walking along the coach, checking passports. They get to the back and they find a suspicious package. an empty
your heart just goes,
wrapper of a marijuana joint. and they spoke to the two guys who were in the immediate vicinity. And they're like, what is this? And they're like, where are you from? They're like, Colombia? And that just sent alarm bells ringing. They had American passports too. I'm like, in this situation, please be American. But anyway, we got pulled off into a separate bay, everyone off, luggage off, drug sniffer dogs on board. Thankfully, nothing found, no further incident we're allowed to go. Please, what happens in Amsterdam stays in Amsterdam. Don't bring anything on board. We are crossing borders, so that can end.
What happens in Amsterdam stays in Amsterdam.
That delay would have held you up on such a long drive. That's a long, long drive that
day. It was a big day. I think we lost like half an hour. It wasn't too bad.
Oh, okay. The Swedish border guards are pretty efficient.
The inconvenience and the invasion of privacy for some of the other guests. Germanic sort of region. So.
We actually never mind being stopped by the Swedish border guards because everybody is very happy with the eye candy, both the male and
female. I was about to say, because the men are beautiful,
there's, you know, they're very equal in Sweden too, so there's like as many female border guards and police as there are male.
Beautiful blonde hair, ladies.
Yes.
And like Victoria, ooh. You do have a bit of a Nordic vibe to you, Victoria. Yeah. You're very tall as well.
I'm not tall. I'm short.
You are. Maybe you just have a tall persona.
Thank you. Anyway, what were you saying, Brandon?
Oh no. So, you know, it's happened a few times to me where guests have left their passports in their room, and my pet hate is when they leave them in safes in their rooms. Because that's just it's such a difficult thing to try and get the hotel to get it out the safe to then put it on a FedEx. And get it to you. Has that kind of stuff ever happened to you?
Yeah, man. The amount of time dedicated to trying to get
it. Technically, you're not allowed to cross the border without it. So sometimes you have to leave the tour and go back and get your passport and wait and catch up. So definitely don't leave your passport under your pillow or in the safe or anywhere.
I've come up with a little bit of a solution to it over recent years. It's happened to me a few times. So what I do now is if I know a hotel has a safe in their room, because some people, it's their habit, they will put their passports in the safe, and that's fine. But what I ask them to do, if they are going to do that, then put one of your shoes. So take one shoe and put it in the safe. So the next morning when you're trying to get dressed, you're looking for your other shoe, and you're like, oh, it's in the safe.
Genius, so, Brandon. Yeah, well, that's absolutely genius.
Yeah, well, when if I use a safe, I'll put my whole man bag in the safe. Because I feel naked without it. So where's my bag? It's in the safe. I don't take the passport and the money out because I'm about to get that. Whole bag goes in.
Oh, my goodness. You just, wow, that's a good one. Yeah, both of you. So I have one quick story at the border as well. And it was just a guy who decided to use the bus toilet when everyone else go through passport control. And it's one of those borders with two borders. So, you know, normally in Europe you have like the border of the country you're leaving and then you have a bit of a no man's land and then the border of the country that you're entering into. So, yeah, luckily it ended up being okay because the border guards didn't check the toilet and didn't find him. But that, like me and the bus driver could have been done for, like, people smuggling, because that man ended up
you're a human trafficker,
for human driving across the border and not going through passport control.
It's so easy done though, because like when the coach stops, that's such a symbol for people. He's like, oh, toilet time. So your body's like, yeah, stopping.
It does it's become a signal.
Time to go to the toilet. And because that becomes the habit throughout the tour. So it always happens to me when we're usually at Dunkirk and we get out to do the border check there before we get on the ferry. And I've had it three times in one season where someone's gone into the toilet, locked the door. They haven't driven across, but then the guards come and done the checks. They've come out the door and they're like, what are you doing in here? Like, why is the toilet locked? There's just someone in there. And it's like, man, it's the worst time to use the toilet.
Yeah. Do you play the wake up song beforehand and they just get that
thing? Well, yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's it. That song is like, the wee is coming. So
it's bad how there's no toilets there until you get across, though, isn't it? Because
this should be so in that. In that passport bay, once you go through the British side, there should be somewhere. But
guys, I'm going to start to wrap it up a little bit because I can just see our time's about to run out. So we were going to talk about losing things and also about public transport mishaps because I love your story, Brandon, about the...
Should I do it briefly?
Oh, yeah.
Do it quickly. Tell us quickly before we have 100%. To go.
So basically, there's one of the most lovely ladies who've ever been on one of my tours. She was the cutest thing and all she wanted to do was photography. She wasn't interested in going to museums. She wasn't interested in eating the food. She just wanted to take photos. And she had a habit of getting lost. So I got used to finding her. But the one time she got lost, we were in Bratislava in Slovakia. And she decided to just to call me and say, hi, Brandon, I'm lost again. So my process with her was this. Okay, so my darling, what I want you to do is point out some buildings and describe them for me, and then I will come and find you. So she starts talking about buildings. And nothing is ringing a bell in Bratislava. I'm like, oh my goodness, I have no idea where she is. And then at the end, so I said, Margaret, I can't find you. Like, I need you, because she had one of those cell phones with no internet, so she doesn't have, you know, Google Maps or anything. So I said, please just, find anything that looks like a road sign or whatever, and then I'll find you. And she said, well, I did get on a local bus. You got on a local bus? So she could be anywhere. So she told me the number of the local bus and I'm trying to track the route, but she basically had gone the opposite side of the city. So she crossed the Danube River and she was in the kind of the central business district of the city rather than the historical center. But eventually we found her. But my heart, just sank because I didn't want to lose her in Bratislava.
It's like, it's so easy done though, is it? Like so many times when like you have some free time and I'm a wanderer. Yeah. So when I go to places, I like to go off and do my own thing. And somebody's like, oh, I'm going to go here, go there. And like next thing you know, you end up in the middle of nowhere and you've got these strict time limits. And another bad one is like, I think Matt was saying like when people want to find the bus on their own, you set a meeting place in town and you're like, okay, we're going to meet here at this statue at this time and then we're going to go back to the bus together, because the bus doesn't always stay in the bus park. Sometimes it picks somewhere else.
Please,
and some people are like, no, I'm not going to meet you there. I'm just going to go to the bus on my own and that'll be fine. And it never ends well.
Is it like that place, what's that place in Poland, Matt, with the square and the goats that bang heads in the, is it?
Oh, Poznan.
Poznan. Yeah, so it's a perfect square. And one of my passengers, he went, so, you go that way and then go to the square, and he went like the complete diagonal opposite. And the thing is, it really is unfair to the other passengers, isn't it? Like to hold people up for, Hey guys, we're going to run out of time. The recording is going to finish. So,
let's say the goodbyes.
Thanks for tuning in this week and we hope you found it entertaining. Don't forget next week, we're going to be talking with Willem from South Africa. Brandon's home. It's bye from New Zealand. Bye from me.
Yeah. Amazing. Goodbye from South Africa. Thanks so much for listening.
And good night from Australia.
And goodbye from a laggy, maybe frozen Luke whose internet isn't being very good. But maybe you can hear me. See you later.
No, we can see and hear you. It's Brandon that's frozen. Anyway, bye, guys.
See you guys.